Hi, I'm Dr. Johnny, and today we're talking about widening the mouth with dermal filler. Okay, so lip filler, we all know everyone seems to want lip filler, whether it's to create shape, to make the lip look youthful, to create a sexy looking lip, or for vertical lip lines, people all refer to those things as lip filler and rejuvenation of the perioral area. And I'm just, right now, I'm preparing a lecture for Bangkok. We had a conference over there on the whole perioral rejuvenation. And I had a question off the YouTube channel. Hey, Dr. Rajani, can you talk about how to make the mouth wider with filler? When I thought about that question, the first thing that comes to mind is, why do you want it wider? Well, the new look, or the look of all the models and the superstars, is a wider looking mouth. Many factors go into whether that can be created, why are we wanting that now, and the facial numbers and structure. So does it fit with the face? So I thought I'd go through three factors that we consider with making the mouth wider. You can follow along on Instagram as well. We have a lot of great topics on lip filler and everything about facial rejuvenation there. And some upcoming videos with regard to the lip, we'll be talking about the ergotrid, or the distance from the top of the lip to the nose, another hot topic, and the lip lift, either surgical or non. And also I'm gonna review all natural lip fillers, because a lot of people might not want fillers or other substances placed in the body like silicone for their lips, or maybe they're not allowed to do it. And so they're looking for an all natural option. So those are on the dock to get set up. So look forward to those. So the first factor about widening the mouth is considering product. And I was in Miami last weekend and someone in the audience had asked, the duck lip, why do we create the duck lip and where did it come from? Well, one of the reasons is we only had collagen back in 2000, 2003 in this country. And it didn't last long if you put it in the body of the lip, but it was soft and elegant, didn't draw water in. So the best place to put that product was in the vermilion border. And then we got hyaluronic acid fillers, so new structural products that we can create shape with, and people continue to put it in the border of the lip like we did with collagen. The problem is it's a more robust filler. So as we got these new products, we were able to do more things, but we had to adjust over time for filling not like we did with collagen, but more like we do with hyaluronic acids. Since that time, we have new hyaluronic acids, which are structural, create support, and don't draw water in. That's another key component of making the mouth wider. We need structural products. And the older products wouldn't have worked for this, and they didn't last. Then we went to Restylane, 2003 is the first one. Juvederm then came in 2007. That does draw a little water in. You can create structure and support with that too, but over time, if it's not done right, or you try and create too much structure with too much filler, as it draws the water in, which is a very nice property in some circumstances, but if not, it can create a sausage lip. And then we went through that phase. But now we do have products that are structural, supportive, and that don't draw water in. This is allowing us to create a wider lip. So the first consideration is product, what product people want to use to create that. And we do have that product that can do it. I will caution, there's a lot of products out there. Some are permanent, silicone, some people use PMMA, people use crazy stuff, fix it flat. I just heard of overseas getting product in. It's called very similar to a product here. The name is very similar to a product that we have here. And I called to say, hey, what are the concentrations? Ask a few questions about it. It was nothing like what we get in this country. It's very, very scary. So know what you're getting. Know what product your injector is already thinking, if you want a wider mouth, what product to use and what would be best. But just know, find out what you're going to get in your lip. And the key is making sure it's an approved product in this country And hyaluronic acids are the number one we use because they are dissolvable. They do go down over time, but they also don't have the permanent products that you problems that you can get in a lip, such as PMMA or silicone. The body fights those. You get granulomas, bumps and lumps. And remember, the bone changes around the face, so that the lip filler might look great for 10 or 20 years, but as that ergotrid lengthens, as the piriform aperture opens and the lip takes a different shape, that permanent product might not be in the right place. Other areas, I don't mind permanent products. We have PMMA, we have long-term products like Sculptra, but stay away from it for the lip. So that's the first consideration, is what product, and it's nice to know we do have the product. The second consideration is anatomy. Can they take it? Will the lip look good if we have that wider mouth? And it's really important. I know a lot of people want to inject themselves at home. People want to go to the cheapest place, the most, we'll call it cost-effective place. But what you're paying for and why someone else is doing it to you is because they can look at all angles and dimensions. And what's going through your injector's mind, just like I talked about one of my last videos on the brow lift, is angles, folds, and as they inject, they're watching what's possible. Because it's not always possible. As we inject, we switch gears. We use different techniques. We might do the body, vermilion border lip, then go to the body, the wet dry border, and then inject the philtrum or the Cupid's bow based on what we're seeing, or we might avoid some of those things. So it's an art in progress, and it's not only based on just standard anatomy, most important, it's your anatomy. And everyone, if I inject 7 or 8 lips in a day, every single one is different. Even though in their mind they might know what they want, what we can actually create is different from maybe what they want. And it's based on their anatomy. And knowing the anatomy and the angles, if you take this diagram, for instance, and you take a line, you draw it straight down from the inner portion of the colored eye, you will see that that usually lines up with the lateral border of the lip, but it's not that simple because there are genetic differences, of course, differences around the world, so cultural differences. Also, masseter differences. A wider masseter takes a wider mouth. And then there are designer differences. So anatomy, those top two pillows of the lip, there's two lateral, one on each side, and a central pillow. And on the bottom, there's only two. So you can imagine if you're trying to fill the lip laterally to create a wider looking mouth, and it's making the pillow of the lip look funky, if it's making it look drawn out, if it's resting on their lower lip in an unusual way, and you can often only tell from a lateral view, then the injector will stop and switch gears. And sometimes we're using the injection technique, a standard technique, and other times we might switch to the pillar technique, and you'll watch my video on that, because you're gonna get different projections. So switching gears based on the anatomy, is it correct? Is it gonna look good? Could it work for you? And always evaluating as we're filling, because multiple ideas, multiple injection techniques are going through your injector's mind as they inject the correct product that we talked about. The third concept to consider in creating a wider mouth is that this occurs often over time. It's one of those areas that we fill that we, kind of like an implant, we create a little bit of stretch on the tissue. We're also looking to see how it fills. And we want more fill towards the center, of course, and a lateral taper. If we flip the lip forward, and there's many ways to do it with filler, and sometimes we add toxin too, or neuromodulators, then, and it looks good, it looks natural, then that allows us to taper it laterally with more product. If, however, it's looking too full in the center, we really can't go laterally with the filler. Over time, we can kind of create balance and harmony and actually get volume laterally, but it's something that occurs over time. We know the stretch of fibers creates long-term collagen, and that's a benefit of fillers, and we found this out long ago because as the filler dissipates, there was still effect, lifting effect, volume effect, and type 2 and 3 collagen are produced around stretching. That's the theory, is the stretch of the fibers. But in this case, it's stretching that creates volume and allows us to go laterally. So think, a lot of people come in now and they'll purchase a vial of filler and they'll purchase two more because really what their goal, they know they're going to use it, the filler dissipates, and oftentimes at 1 to 2 months, if it's the first time getting filler, is a good time to allow the filler to accommodate and the patient to accommodate to one vial, and then you can add another vial, and then it might be a year, might be 8 months, might be a year and a half before they add more. But oftentimes places will offer a volume discount and you're developing a relationship with your provider over time to get the look. Also, they have your pictures and you can look, what did it look like when I came in after one vial, two vials? Maybe you don't want the third. Maybe you want to put that to something different. But in general, purchasing three vials would be pretty normal for someone wanting lip filler and creating a look over time. Most importantly is following the patient's look, so we're not creating bizarre looks, unusual looks, and it has to be congruent with the whole face. We can't have new lips on an older looking frame and face. So that's something to have a good discussion with your provider, and as a provider, it's important to give the full facial consult so people know, hey, once you do the lip area, you at least, if you're of a stage where there's hollow around the temple, the preauricular area, or there's that downturn of the mouth, addressing that sometimes to get a wider look is much more important, because if you get a wider look to the lip, it might accentuate a squaring look that's created with age. We all square as we age, and as a wider lip can look not balanced on a square face. So lifting the edge of the mouth, and watch my video on that, the downturned mouth or how to lift the corners of the mouth. That's why a lot of times when people purchase multiple vials for the lip filler, they address the lip, but also now with the new flexible structural fillers, we can address the downturn of the mouth with PDO threads, with fillers, with neuromodulators. So it all works together in harmony. So there's three things to consider about lip fillers, about widening the mouth. Join us for further videos. I'm teeing up some videos right now on the ergotrid, which is the length between the Cupid's bow and the nose. It's a big topic. A lot of people ask about it. They know surgery is possible, but non-surgical methods can work for some as well. And the all-natural lip filler. Join us here on YouTube. Subscribe to our family here and over on Instagram to keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.